Nowadays, most big companies have some sort of bug bounty program. When you're an Apple, Adobe, Microsoft, and a bunch of others, paying what really amounts to maybe a couple hundred thousand a year for good PR and less issues being sold in the black market that your customers are going to be really annoyed by, is basically a no-brainer. And today, we are talking about one company in particular that does have a bug bounty program, that being Zendesk, the customer service platform used by tons of companies like Uber, Shopify, Twitter, Slack, Reddit, and thousands of others, many of which are Fortune 500 companies. This is a very important piece of software, so if you could find maybe, I don't know, some exploit to bring out data from the platform that shouldn't be brought out, that might be pretty bad. This is a post from about 2 weeks ago, but even so, I still need to talk about it. One bug, $50,000 plus in bounties, how Zendesk intentionally left a backdoor in hundreds of Fortune 500 companies. Now, obviously, being a giant company used by other giant companies, this encourages more and more companies to trust the platform and to use the platform. But that's not the only reason that people use Zendesk. It's easy to set up. You link it to your company support email like support@company.com, and Zendesk starts managing incoming emails and creating tickets. You can handle these tickets yourself or have a support team do it for you. Zendesk is a billion-dollar company trusted by big names like Cloudflare. Cloudflare is a small fish compared to some of the companies that make use of Zendesk. Personally, I've always found it surprising that these massive companies worth billions rely on third-party tools like Zendesk instead of building their own in-house ticketing systems. Well, I don't find it that surprising, because if there is a solution that already exists out there and it's a trusted solution by all of these companies, it's a lot cheaper to just go and use that than build something from the ground up that's going to have a bunch of problems that Zendesk hopefully has already dealt with, and maybe in the long run a custom solution would be cheaper. But at least in the near to medium term, that seems like a nightmare. It is the exact same reason that massive companies make use of AWS. The infrastructure is there, you get to use it for a relatively nominal cost, and all of the problems are hopefully just dealt with for you. But as the saying goes, you're only as strong as your weakest link. Since Zendesk is just seen as a basic ticketing tool, companies often set it up without much thought. The most common setup I've seen is forwarding all emails from support@company.com to Zendesk. Why is that dangerous? Many companies use @company.com domain for single sign-on, which lets employees quickly log in to internal tools, whether that be their Slack or their GitLab or other things like that. By connecting Zendesk to the same domain, companies unknowingly create a potential security gap. Zendesk handles all emails for the domain it's configured for, which means if your SSO system doesn't properly validate email addresses, anyone who gains access to your Zendesk could potentially exploit this and access your internal systems. We will be getting into that a bit later, because this is very much involved in how he got Zendesk to pay attention. Now, by doesn't properly validate email addresses, this means doesn't deal with email spoofing. So if there are companies that are not doing so, and you find some sort of email spoofing related exploit, maybe there is some way to get into these systems. Well, I discovered a serious vulnerability in Zendesk that allowed attackers to read customer support tickets from any company using Zendesk. All they had to do was send a crafted email to a support email handed by Zendesk. The shocking part, Zendesk didn't seem to care. The bug itself was surprisingly simple. Zendesk had no effective protection against email spoofing, and this oversight made it possible to exploit the email collaboration feature to gain access to other tickets. So here's how it works. When you send an email to a company's Zendesk support portal, Zendesk creates a new support ticket. To keep track of the email thread, Zendesk automatically generates a reply to address, which looks like this. Support plus ID, the ID that is set to, @company.com, where the ID is the unique ticket number. So in the case of an incremental numbering system, if this is ticket number one, this would be support plus ID one at company.com. The next ticket is support plus ID two at company.com. This address ensures that any future replies you send go directly to the same ticket. Now that by itself, absolutely no problem. The problem comes in with the ticket collaboration. If you CC someone on one of your email replies, Zendesk automatically adds them to the ticket, allowing them to see the full ticket history in the support portal. Now, normally what should happen is only the person who made the ticket or employees at the company who have the ability to see the ticket should be able to CC people. That's not the case though. The exploit was simple. If an attacker knew the support email address and the ticket ID, which are usually easy to guess since ticket IDs are incremental, they could use email spoofing to impersonate the original sender. Now, this does mean you need to know the email address of the person who opened the ticket, which is pretty annoying, unless you're doing specifically targeted attacks. For example, targeting employees at the company because a list of company emails is public, or was leaked, or for whatever other reason, you have access to them. By sending a fake email to support plus ID, the ID at company.com, from the requester's email address, which is relatively easy to do through email spoofing if they don't have proper systems in place, and then CCing their own email address, CCing your own email address, Zendesk would think the email was legitimate. It would then add the attacker's email to the ticket, giving them full access to the entire ticket history. This meant an attacker could effectively join any ongoing support conversation and read sensitive information, all because Zendesk didn't have proper safeguards against email spoofing. So if you have a list of email addresses you know are using a company Zendesk, literally all you do is just iterate over every support ticket, sending a fake email trying to tag your email from that address, and you'll start getting hits relatively quickly. This is a pretty bad problem. So not being someone trying to sell things on the black market or trying to go to prison, he went ahead and reported the problem to Zendesk, or to Zendesk through the HackerOne program. Hi, thank you for your submission. Unfortunately, this particular issue you reported is explicitly out of scope as outlined in the policy page. SPF, DKIM, and DMARC issues. Your effort is nonetheless appreciated, and we wish that you'll continue to research and submit any future security issues you find. Best regards, H1 Analyst Layla. But this wasn't a response from Zendesk. This was a response from the HackerOne service program they use, where basically they will go and check, is this a serious problem? Is this something that actually needs to be dealt with? And then it'll be forwarded on to Zendesk to make sure the problem actually gets dealt with. So because this was an actual serious problem that a Zendesk employee needed to see, he was like, okay, I'm gonna send them another email and let's see what happens here. Thank you for your report and follow-up discussion regarding the support ticket email spoofing vulnerability. As a HackerOne mediator, I reviewed the report details, activities, and Zendesk bug bounty policy thoroughly. While we acknowledge that the ability to gain unauthorized access to support tickets is a serious matter, Zendesk policy explicitly lists SPF, DKIM, DMARC issues under the Bounty Ineligible Issues section. Since the root cause of this vulnerability involves email spoofing, by bypassing those email authentication protocols, it falls squarely into the excluded issues per the policy. I understand your perspective that the potential impacts makes this a high-risk vulnerability regardless of the prerequisites. However, bug bounty programs have to draw clear lines around scope to manage expectations and workload. It sounds like the scope might need to be expanded to ensure that serious vulnerabilities are dealt with. So, since they weren't going to pay him, I guess he can get paid elsewhere. Not by going and selling a vulnerability, that would be really bad, but by going to the companies directly and seeing what they have to say about it. Not by reporting the problem to them, that would be pretty simple. No. by using this exploit to break into Slack instances. Now, here's the really fun thing here. This is not the first time that Zendesk has been used to do exactly this. Back in 2017, there was a blog post about the exact same thing. How I hacked hundreds of companies through their help desk. Now, the exploit done here is different. The result is basically the same though. Since many companies use Slack SSO on the same domain as Zendesk, the researcher figured out that he could complete email verifications through a support@company.com email and gain access to private Slack channels. Back then, Zendesk wasn't as big, and there were some bugs that allowed anyone to view your tickets if they had your email. I realized that I could replicate this exploit using my bug, but with a few challenges to overcome. Now on Slack's side, they did make it a little bit more complex by now adding a randomly generated token to the email. Indy's exploit, like mine, required the attacker to know the sending email address of the verification code. Slack added random tokens to their email addresses to combat similar attacks in the future. It was impossible to know what email they would send the verification email from. Unless, while Slack used a random email token when sending email verification, neither Google or Apple did. Slack supported both methods for OAuth login. Now the exploit was simple. Create a Google account with support@company.com email, request verification code, use my bug to access the ticket Zendesk automatically creates when it arrives, verify the Google account, log in with Google to Slack. That was perfect. But it wouldn't work with Google because they send the email from a no reply address and Zendesk rightfully blocks no reply addresses. Apple doesn't use a no reply address though, so just do the same thing but from the Apple side. So this exploit is really stupid. Create an Apple account with support@company.com email and request a verification code. Again, we are spoofing this email address. We don't actually have it, but we are tricking Zendesk into thinking we do. Apple sends the verification code from Apple ID at id.apple.com to support@company.com and Zendesk automatically creates a ticket. At the same time, create your ticket on their support portal from your own email address. This allows you to keep track of the ID range. Use the email spoofing bug mentioned earlier to attempt to add yourself to every ticket within the range from earlier. This is just a simple script that just automatically sends those emails. Log into the company support portal from your account and view your CC tickets. And that verification email has been attached to your account. Enter the verification code in Apple, and then use Slack's login with Apple feature and login with the Apple account connected to the company's email. And then he went and broke into hundreds of companies' private Slack channels to let them know that Zendesk seems pretty insecure. I spent about a week reporting the vulnerability to individual companies. Some of them took immediate action and patched their instances, while others argued that it was a Zendesk issue. Then something interesting happened. A comment appeared on my original HackerOne report. We kindly request you to keep this report between you and Zendesk. We received tickets from customers regarding this issue, mentioning you, and it caused unnecessary communications on our end. They state that you were able to use this vulnerability to gain access to their Slack instance, but you've not provided that detail to us. Could you share your ticket trick POC demonstrating this? Now, the Slack thing was a way to demonstrate the issue that he'd already demonstrated to them. The reason why he did this is because you guys weren't paying attention, and this is how he got your attention. Keep in mind, the difference between a white hat hacker and a black hat hacker is how much you annoy them that day. They're just two sides of the exact same coin. They are chaotic neutral. They can go in either direction very, very easily. Some companies must have contacted Zendesk after receiving a report, and the pressure from this issue had essentially forced Zendesk's hand. I hadn't mentioned the Slack exploit in my original report to them because I hadn't discovered it at that point. Now they wanted full detailed reproduction steps for the Slack takeover. I provided the proof of concept for the Slack vulnerability and they confirmed the issue. Though they claimed they had started working on a fix, it would actually take them over 2 months to resolve it. Once companies vulnerable to this were alerted to the issue, many of them quickly disabled Zendesk email collaboration feature to protect their instances. Over the course of my reporting, I earned more than $50,000 in bounties from individual companies, not from Zendesk. Just individual companies were like, thank you, we didn't know about the problem, here's some money. Don't do anything bad to us with it whilst we fix this on our end. And this is probably the real reason why Zendesk wasn't happy about this. At least one or two companies reportedly cut ties with Zendesk after my disclosure. Now, following this report being publicly posted, Zendesk did actually post their own public response. This email we see here is just explaining what the problem was and how they went and resolved it. Here is what they said to the public, which got quite downvoted and has zero comments because they closed it for comments. We want to address the bug bounty program associated with this case. Although the researcher did initially submit the vulnerability through our established process, they violated key ethical principles by directly contacting third parties about their report prior to remediation. This was in violation of bug bounty terms of service, which are industry standard and intended to protect the white hat community while also supporting responsible disclosure. The breach of trust resulted in the forfeiture of their award, as we maintain strict standards for responsible disclosure. The reward that they weren't going to be paid anyway, until they made this publicly available, or at least available to the companies to let them know there was a problem, because the bug was out of scope. Again, do not tempt the white hat hacker. If they report a bug that appears to be an actual bug, as was originally confirmed, even if it's outside the scope of the bug bounty program, at least confirm, yes, this is a bug, we are working on a solution, it'll be fixed. Otherwise chaotic neutral can quickly become chaotic evil. But what do you think? Do you think the exploit is actually serious? Do you think it mattered? And what do you think of the approach of getting the company to notice? I would love to know. So if you like the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe to LiberaPay, link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and before you go and try this, this has already been patched, and don't do that, because that's a crime.